Love it or loathe it, it's one of the oldest spiritual rituals.
It's just a chance to nourish your body with foods that God created.
The keys to fasting on today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, welcome to the show. Whether it's low carb, low fat, low calorie, the health industry is filled with crazes that are guaranteed to change your body.
Well, today we don't want to talk about changing your body, but instead changing your perspective. Take a look.
Why is it so important that I fast? I don't like being hungry. If I go hungry, then will God hear me? Can I just fast a little TV or caffeine? Or does it always have to be something big? How long do I have to fast for it to mean something? I really don't have the time or the patience right now to fast. I'm busy. I need to relax. What's wrong with not fasting?
Well, today we're going to talk about fasting, and I think people have some misconceptions about it. The first one is that somehow or other, fasting gets you points with God, that it somehow gets you more favor in Him, that you can purchase things from God by fasting and how much you deny yourself. That's on one side of it. The other side of it is, you look at the Christian writers, and you can go back as far as the 7th century with Simon of Syria, and he said, the mysteries of God are never revealed to the full stomach. So where's the balance, and how do you find balance, and what does the Bible say about fasting? Well, first, let's look at the Old Testament, and I'll just run through some real quick ones here. There's Ezra chapter 9, where he was mourning, and he tore his garment and his robe, and that was how he was fasting. Then you look at Nehemiah, what he mourned, and when he went through his fasting period, he fasted and mourned for many days. Then Esther, when the decree went out that all the Jews could be killed, well, there was a great mourning among the Jews with fasting, weeping, and wailing. And the Psalms points this out and sort of backs this up, that in the Old Testament, fasting was for weeping. Fasting was for mourning. But fasting is also to humble yourself. And when you are fasting, sometimes your prayers come back on yourself. They return to your own heart. Psalm 69, I wept and chastened my soul with fasting. So fasting for weeping, for mourning, for chastening, for humbling. And then in Daniel, and we're talking about Daniel fasts a lot in church these days, I set my face toward the Lord God to make requests by prayer and supplications with fasting. So Daniel sets himself to make a request of God by first humbling himself, that he sets his face, and it shows that I'm setting my face to inquire of the Lord. Then we have Joel 2, all from the Old Testament. Turn to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. So fasting is a mourning, fasting is a weeping, fasting is a humbling, fasting is a turning to God, fasting is setting your face towards God. Now, in the New Testament era, which we live in, some people say, well, fasting is done, it's over with, because the disciples of Jesus didn't fast. The disciples of John did, and Jesus said, well, when the bridegroom is with you, you don't need to fast. But he also said this, and a lot of us overlook it. Matthew 6, verse 16, moreover, when you fast, and then he gives instructions, don't be like the hypocrites where you make a big show of your fast. And so I just want to underline, when you fast. And so it's an instruction for us as Christians that we need to fast, and it needs to be a regular part of our walk with Jesus. Why? Because there's certain things that happen when you fast. The first thing that we need to recognize is that you put your flesh subject to your spirit and your will. So often we walk through life and we're not aware that the desires of our body can overwhelm our spirit and even overwhelm our will. I think we've all experienced the ice cream in the freezer speaking to you and getting you to say, okay, I want to come eat a whole bunch of ice cream. When that's happening to you, what you're surrendering to is the desires of the body. And that can get to be something far worse than just ice cream in the freezer. There's nothing wrong with eating ice cream, but there is a lot wrong in allowing the desires of your flesh to overcome your will. And so it's a method for us to subjugate our flesh, to say, I want my spirit. I want the spirit to be in touch with the living God, and I don't want my flesh to be in the way. I want my flesh subject to my will so that my body is in the proper alignment. That can be a wonderful thing for Christians, and it will release a lot of desire for God. And that's why Simeon the Syrian said, the mysteries of God aren't revealed to a full stomach. Now, here's a verse that I think has caused a lot of difficulty in the church and some misinterpretation. And it has to do with the story of a man who brought his demon-possessed son to Jesus. And first he brought his son to the disciples, and they could not cast out the demon. And Jesus complains about that. And he calls them a wicked and perverse generation. And then he says to the demon, get out, and the demon leaves. And then the disciples have to have a conference with Jesus. And you find it in Matthew 17. The disciples came to Jesus privately and said, why couldn't we cast it out? And Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief. And let me just underline and stop there. Our failure as Christians to exercise the power gifts is that's the reason. It's because of our unbelief. We want to walk through life thinking, yes, I believe. But when you get right up into a very difficult circumstance, that's exactly when our unbelief is revealed. And we don't want to look at it that way. We want to somehow blame God. And when we want to say, well, I haven't done enough, and I haven't been good enough, and I haven't prayed enough, and I haven't fasted enough. And somehow it's God's fault, it's ours, and because we didn't do these things. But really, you know, God was stingy that day. We've got to put the cause right where Jesus put it. Because of your unbelief. For assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, he goes on and he talks about moving mountains. If we just have a little bit of faith, and nothing will be impossible for you. And then he adds, however, this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting. What prayer and fasting does, because it's limiting your flesh, because you're meditating on the Lord, what it does, it actually increases what you believe, because you've been in closer contact with him. Your spirit is now ascendant over your body. And so when you get into those difficult circumstances, you know, how do I pray? What do I do? You are already in communion with the Lord. You know exactly what to do. And your flesh is now subject to your spirit. And it increases your ability to believe. You're not earning brownie points with God. You're not getting the merit badge with God. But it is a way to allow your spirit to be over your flesh. Now let's look at what happens in the New Testament age when people fast. And you find it, the first one, Acts 10, verse 30, and this is Cornelius, and it's an important time because he's the first Gentile convert. Peter has a great vision, and at the same time, Cornelius has a vision. And he says to Peter, 4 days ago, I was fasting until this hour, and at the ninth hour, I prayed in my house, and behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing. Now, there's a lot going on in Cornelius's life. It's not just prayer and fasting. He is giving to the poor. He is living a righteous life. And the angel announces to him, your gifts have come before the Lord. So there's a lot going on. You don't fast to get revelation. Revelation comes because you're asking for it and you're living a life in accordance with Scripture. It's not a merit system where, again, you're earning things with God. You're not. But what it does do is it sets you up for spiritual encounters. The other time in Acts where people fasted, you find it in Acts 14, when they had appointed elders in every church, and this is Paul, he's getting ready to leave. So they appointed elders to take over the church and prayed with fasting. They commended them to the Lord in whom they had believed. And the overall emphasis here, they believed in the Lord. They were trusting these new churches to the elders. And the reason they were able to trust the elders is because they believed in the Lord. And they did all of that with fasting and prayer. So if you're looking for things from God, realize faith is the pathway. It's what you believe, and what you believe shows up in what you do. So if you want to believe more, make sure your spirit is the one in charge. Make sure your will is the one in charge and not your body. And fasting is a great way to humble yourself and put your body subject to your will. So how can you fast and focus on God while still balancing everything else that's going on in your life? Well, Daniel Fast, author Kristen Feola, explains right after this. They had careers, homes, and money.
I feel like my whole life has been just turned upside down.
And then they risked it all.
The plan in Nepal is to help manage and run an orphanage and employ some of the local widows there.
Why they say they would do it all over again on the next 700 Club Interactive.
It hindered my ability to walk or run. I had to cancel lessons all the time and cancel all the programs that I had planned. And I saw my career gone. I had never really understood the purpose of money even and what my responsibilities were. And I always thought that we had to have a lot to give. And the more I gave, the more kids would come. I'd like to say, you know, it's my great skills or something. It's not. I'm giving to God. I'm obeying. I'm obedient. That's it.
I chose CBN because it helped me find a way to help change the world for Christ.
My business has grown five times what it was in 2005. Five times that. I think any type of investment or any type of giving is an act of faith. I can't, to be honest with you, I can't wait to write the check. It's the best investment that I can imagine. You can't outgive God.
Drank until about 5 o'clock in the morning, passed out, hit a car head on.
I can't really express in words the hollowness of that feeling. I was sentenced to serve 7 years in prison. My bunkmate, he just looked at me and shook his head, said, "It's a real shame. You really have a heart that God could use if you would just let him."
God is a God of restoration, reconciliation, and redemption. There is always hope in Jesus.
Well, before the break, we talked about the spiritual benefits of fasting, and joining us now to talk about the practical side of it is author Kristen Feola. Kristen, welcome. So nice to have you on the Interactive Show today. Should mention the Daniel Fast is the name of your book, and you talk about lots of things in here, but you talk about four different kinds of fasts. Talk about that a minute.
Right. There are four. The absolute fast, which is when you go without food and water for a short period of time, such as when Esther fasted. Mm-hmm. There is the liquid fast, and the partial fast, which is the Daniel fast. And there's also a supernatural absolute, which is without food and water for a longer period of time, such as when Jesus fasted in the desert.
Uh-huh. And there must be some parameters to that, I'm sure.
Right, right. You must have a definite word from God to do that one.
Yes, I am sure so. What? Talk a little bit about, because your book is just rich with suggestions and pictures and recipes. What are some of the foods that you want to include in a fast, and what are the foods that you would avoid?
You want to have whole grains, beans, legumes, nuts, seeds, fruits and vegetables, of course. And then you're avoiding meat, dairy, sugar, caffeine, mm-hmm. those foods that you really crave sometimes, setting those aside.
And now, Gordon talked about some of the spiritual reasons for doing that, but there are, from a health standpoint, some very practical reasons for fasting. What do you think those are?
Absolutely. It's just a chance to nourish your body with foods that God created. It's a healthy way to eat. It's well-balanced. You get plenty of vitamins and minerals and protein, so it's an overall good eating plan.
How often do you fast?
Well, that depends.
Do you have a system that you follow, or do you do it as you feel led to? I mean, there would be a difference between doing it, I think, for physical reasons and doing it for spiritual reasons.
Really both. I usually lead an online fast through my website every January. I like to start the year focusing on God, praying about things that are to come. And then there are periodic fasts that come up during the year, sometimes planned, sometimes not. Mm-hmm. So it varies.
Well, let's talk about some of the options that you have brought with you today so that people can see how absolutely, if this was smell-o-vision, you would know how really wonderful these recipes smell. They're sitting right in front of me. But first of all, you have a shake. Talk a little bit about what's in the shake and the why behind it.
This is a strawberry banana smoothie.
Excuse me.
That's
you can
okay.
tell what I eat.
And it is very creamy, very delicious. It's basically strawberries, banana, a little bit of dates, and some tofu, which you don't even taste. That's what makes it creamy. So lots of protein there. And it's great for breakfast or a snack.
Is it, so you're saying breakfast is kind of a bit of a breakfast replacement,
right,
for you to start the day. And is it still true that breakfast is the most important meal
yes.
of the day for us? It
Absolutely.
Kind of gets the engine running. Okay, well, that looks delicious. But this is what I am smelling that smells so fabulous. This is like a family meal that you've prepared here.
Yes, this is the black bean chili bake, probably one of the top three recipes in my book that people really enjoy, and it is good for a whole family. It's simple to put together. You've got black beans, rice, roasted red peppers, corn, a little bit of chili powder, and very good, very filling.
And there is dinner, and something simple enough that really the kids could get involved in doing that too.
Yes.
As you're mentioning these ingredients, we have a third thing to go to, but before we get to that, how important is it when you're fasting to be sure you have all the right stuff on hand so you're not coming to the place where it's time to eat something and you're tempted to do the wrong thing?
Yes. Preparation is really key on the Daniel fast, making sure you have the foods that you need. And that's what I try to help people with in my book because that makes it so much easier, having the foods, having the recipes planned ahead of time, so then you just put it together.
It looks delicious. And down on the end you have, what do you call them, almond butter bites?
Yes.
Did you say butter? I like it already.
These are probably one of my favorite recipes because they're so good and they're filled with protein. It's just almond butter, shredded coconut, raisins. It's very good.
And do you do that as like a little dessert treat for yourself, a snack in between what your healthy meals are?
Yes, it is a snack, but it really tastes like dessert. I just love them.
It's a healthy dessert.
They have
dessert.
A little bit of sweetness.
You know, fasting can have some challenges physically, emotionally, psychologically. Talk about what people could encounter with all of that.
Yes, everything. fasting is hard. It's always hard. You know, I talked with a girl the other day and she said, I just don't like fasting. And I don't really know that you like it in that sense because it's difficult, but there's such joy.
You like the result of it.
You like the results in drawing close to the Lord. Mm-hmm. But it's hard because it's not just physical, it's spiritual. So it's a battle. And you have
both
of those.
You're usually never hungrier than when you're fasting, right?
Right.
That temptation. But also, there are some very practical things that happen to people. Like if you are a coffee drinker or a soda drinker, you can experience headaches sometimes.
Yes.
Low blood sugar. So you need to be sure that you're doing this in a healthy way. And there is a healthy way to do it.
Right.
And that's what you write about in the Daniel fast. And it's filled with the information that you need to do this well and to do it so that your body isn't going through any kind of great withdrawal. Well, our viewers have some questions for you, so let's take a look at that. This is Olivia who says, I've been diagnosed with an autoimmune disease and my doctor advised that I maintain a paleo lifestyle, which involves meat. Can I still do a Daniel fast?
I would say yes. But because the Daniel fast is short term, she's talking about a lifestyle of eating. And people do have concerns about that. Can I do this for 3 weeks? Mm-hmm. You know, and to take that break and to say, for 3 weeks, I'm going to just not have meat so I can focus on prayer, I believe God will honor that. Yes. So I would say yes. If it's not detrimental to your health, if it's just a suggested lifestyle, then absolutely should be fine to do that.
Okay. Then Cynthia writes, how do you fast if you have to take medication? Should you fast medication too? Because, you know, some meds say, do not take this on an empty stomach.
Right.
But you don't have to.
Right. That's what's great about the Daniel fast. It allows people who couldn't do a liquid fast to enter in. And I would say if your doctor has you on medication, then you should continue the medication. Mm-hmm. Again, the Lord understands.
Yes.
And do the Daniel fast.
Okay, this is Mandy who says, my husband completed his fourth 40-day fast last year, but his health has suffered ever since. What can I do to help him get his strength, energy, and health back? Now, that's longer than 3 weeks.
Right.
So
right.
Is it possible that maybe when we do some of those 40-day fasts, we're not doing it correctly?
Right. I'd like to know a little bit more about that, what
yes.
type of fast it was, because
right.
it is natural. If that's a liquid fast, 40 days, then you are going to have some weakness. But there also might be some other things going on there. It would probably be good to go to a physician and just make sure there isn't something else happening,
mm-hmm.
get some blood work done. It might not be related yes. to the fast at all.
I consider a 40-day fast, I don't mean extreme in a negative way, but as far as fasting is concerned, an extreme fast to go on. Do you?
I do. Yes, yeah. yes.
For body cleansing purposes, if someone's doing this to be healthy, do you need to do the 3 weeks? Can you do a week? What actually works for you?
I think any type of fast honors the Lord. You could do a one-day fast. Our church right now is in a time where we're praying for certain things every Wednesday. And so I think that's good. You could do a three-day mm-hmm. fast, as you see in the Bible.
Yeah.
But
it's like fasting with intention, isn't
right.
it? That's what Gordon was talking about. Fasting over things that matter.
Right.
And keeping your eye focused on that, I think, helps you stay
right.
the course.
And it's not a formula. It's very individual. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's important to seek the Lord and ask him, what would you have me to do at
yeah.
this time?
Mm-hmm. And you know, when God speaks to your heart about something like that, it really grabs hold of your heart and gives you something that you're shooting for, if you will, on the process of what you're doing. If you'd like more information on the Daniel Fast specifically, Kristen's book, The Ultimate Guide to the Daniel Fast, is available wherever books are sold, full of wonderful wisdom and information. Thank you.
Thank
Great
you,
to have you with us.
Thank you.
Well, still ahead, a realtor drowning in debt discovers fasting is his secret weapon. Hear his story after this.
He thought it was his First Amendment right.
So I did not discriminate against them, just that event.
Until a judge told him otherwise.
The government has chosen which message it favors.
Why this small business owner is standing his ground.
This is not what they taught us in civics class.
Jack stands on the First Amendment. We're going to learn whether the First Amendment has a future in America.
On the 700 Club, next.
I just had hit a point that I couldn't take it anymore.
Can't you get it through your head? I just don't love you.
God, if you are really real, make yourself real to me.
Change my life and put the pieces back together. And if he did it for me, he can do it for anybody. Nothing is impossible with God.
I know how it feels to be alone,
to be hungry,
to be afraid.
I haven't had a birthday party,
my own room,
or a family to call mine. I'm an orphan.
An orphan.
An orphan.
And there are 100 million more like me in the world today.
Together, you and I can make a tremendous difference to someone today. We can change the lives of orphans. I'm asking you to get involved. Give to Operation Blessings Orphans Promise. From Asia to Africa, from Latin America to Europe, you'll be providing housing, food, education, job training, and hope to children who are alone and at risk. Jesus said, whatever you do for the least of these, you do for me. Please give to Orphans Promise and love a child today.
CBN TV on CBN.com. All the video you love in one easy-to-use location.
When America's housing market collapsed, Dale Lawson was left with more than $100,000 in debt. He had no idea how to get himself in the black, so Dale fasted and then discovered the key to living debt-free.
After his divorce, Dale Lawson struggled financially. Because he was a realtor, when the housing market crashed, his income crashed with it.
I only get paid if I sell something. I was a little over $100,000 in debt, in credit card and installment loan debt.
Dale tried to make minimum payments each month on that debt, but even that was proving to be impossible.
I felt extremely desperate, realizing that I had so much going out and not enough coming in to even be close to making those payments. At that point, it was just a nightmare.
Dale eventually moved out of his home and into a cheap motel.
It had old paneled walls that were paper thin. You could hear everything going on in the hotel.
But it was at a hotel like this that Dale decided to fast and pray. It was there that God revealed a very specific truth to him.
My life financially and in many other ways seemed to drastically change for the negative because of not tithing.
So Dale immediately started to tithe again, even though he says it was very hard.
That money should have went for payments. It should have went to the debt. It didn't make sense, but it made sense in that I knew God was there and that he would help me.
Dale says God did begin to help him.
Every month that went by that I didn't miss any payments, just kept building my faith and helping me trust God each month even more.
One month, Dale saw the bills come due and needed more than he had coming in commissions. That month, he received a bonus payment, a gift above and beyond the commission he was due.
I get this check at my office in the mail from a doctor and his wife for the exact amount of those payments, which was $2,000.
Convinced that God was at work in his finances, Dale decided to increase his giving.
I felt like I needed to give even more. And again, this is where the teaching, you know, on the 700 Club and Christian television really helped me. Other people's testimonies really helped me to realize that I wanted to give even more.
Dale became a CBN partner. As he continued to give tithes and offerings, he noticed even more dramatic business growth in a shrinking economy.
I began to see my debts get paid off. A little here, a little there, sometimes a lot. I wasn't working any more hours. I wasn't working any harder. I wasn't doing anything different. And yet it was very clear that God was bringing me customers.
By the end of the third year, Dale was giving away even more. That year, he paid off the last of his $100,000 debt.
My debt began being paid off in large lumps. $7,000, $10,000, $15,000, just from sales.
Dale eventually remarried and has two children. The couple currently give and recently doubled their pledge to CBN because they know the principle of giving works.
To anyone skeptical about giving over and above the tithe and giving to an organization like CBN, I would beg them to try it. Beg them to see what God would do for them.
God will do wonderful things if we just put in place our faith and show Him tangibly how much we believe in His promises. Now here's Dale, he's been humbled. He's lost a lot, and he moves into this hotel, and he decides, I'm going to fast and pray. And in that period of time, God reminded him of, you weren't tithing. It's one thing to tithe when you have. It's a completely other thing, different thing to tithe when you don't, where you're in debt. But it showed that he put his trust in God. It was that mustard seed of faith to say, Lord, I trust you with everything. I trust you with my life. I trust you with my salvation. And now I trust you with my money. And when Dale did that, he unlocked one of the great secrets of the universe, give, and it will be given unto you. If you want to start doing that, give us a call, 888-777-1999. Just say, I want to join the 700 Club. When you do, you're putting into action that mustard seed of faith. For Terry, for me, for all of us here, God bless you. We'll see you again.